Hey everybody, this is Jim, the Tabletop Engineer, and welcome to a new crafting video. Before I get started on this one, I want to talk real quick about just crafting tools in general. I started my channel for one real reason. It's not so much that I'm looking to make money off my videos. It's when I make something, my natural tendency is to want to share it with other people who might benefit from it. I want to say that comes from the background of my career. I was a technical writer forever and ever, and one of the tenets that we that was pounded into us was to document everything we do. Part of the reason we were recommended to do that was it's good practice. When you're a technical writer, you're trying to relay instructions in as simple a manner as you can, but without losing any detail. And that sounds real basic and simple, but believe me, when you're trying to describe how to build something like, an engine or whatever, you could make it as complicated as you want, and maybe 1% of the people who need that information will be able to actually follow it. So, long story short, I started my channel because I figured if I'm going to be making things, I might as well share them with my fellow gamers who might want to make something. Not everything I make, I don't intend for everything I make to necessarily be made by someone else. I'm just sharing with you what I do for my own gaming hobby, and if it can benefit you, that's great. So the reason I'm telling you this is, in the past, I've taken a little bit of heat from a small percentage of my viewers about the fact that I use tools that a lot of people don't necessarily have. Years ago, and I mean literally like maybe 5 or 6 years ago, people were complaining that I don't have a 3D printer. Why are you showing me 3D printed stuff? And now 3D printers are $200, $300, which is still a lot, but compared to the $1,000+ that it used to be, you can see that that tool has come down in price significantly, and a lot more people have access now to 3D printing. So one of the tools I have in my workshop, it's over here to my left, is my laser cutter. I don't know many gamers who have laser cutters. I get it. I use it for my business. I was also trained somewhat in manufacturing technology, so I learned CAD and CAM and CNC, and if those terms don't mean anything to you, they're different methods and tools for making things. And so because I had training in those tools, specifically with my engineering degree, picking up 3D printing or laser cutting or CNC machines, for example, it was just a natural thing for me to pick up as a tool to do things for myself, whether it be around the house or for my hobbies or what have you. So the laser cutter is more for business. I do have a business that I use it for, but I also use it for my own personal benefit. And so I'm telling you this because this particular video is going to focus heavy on that laser cutter and what I've done with it. Specifically, in this video, I'm going to describe to you and show you the software that I use to design the things I cut out on my laser cutter. And along the way, I'm going to try to teach you some things about a laser cutter and how you have to present an image or a design to it in order for it to do its job. Laser cutters are still fairly rare. However, there are these things called makerspaces. If you live in a big city, chances are you've got one or more makerspaces. It's one word, makerspaces. Makerspaces are these places that have been popping up over the last 10 years, maybe a little longer than that. And what they are is they're just a group of people who get together and form a small, typically nonprofit organization, and they put tools in it, and you basically sign up as a member. And one of the ones here in Atlanta, I think, is like $25 a month. And you pay that, and you go in, and they have 3D printers, laser cutters, CNC machines, standard woodworking tools. And not only do I know small businesses here in Atlanta who have used makerspaces to sort of kickstart their business, get it jumped so that they could make things, sell them, and then buy their own equipment and maybe move to their own store. But then again, I've met business owners who basically use makerspaces to make the things that they sell to their customers. So to say I don't have a laser cutter, that is totally a legitimate complaint for a lot of crafters. It's an expensive tool, it's a complicated tool, and you don't find them very often. But makerspaces, a lot of the ones I've encountered, tend to have either a small, medium, or large laser cutter, sometimes all three, and they'll train you on it. I mean, if you're a member of the makerspace, they will train you on how to use it. Usually somebody there is in charge of the laser cutter, and they'll get you trained on it and make sure you understand all the safety features and how to operate it and stuff like that before they sort of let you go. I have even heard rumors. I don't know if this is true, but I suspect it is. I have heard rumors that there are some public libraries that are getting small lasers like a Glowforge or something similar to that. Somebody posted on a Facebook thing not too long ago about how their library had a Glowforge, and I was completely shocked, but it kind of makes sense. Libraries started getting 3D printers a couple years back, and I know the library that I go to here in Georgia or in Atlanta, they had 3D printers, and you basically paid for allotments of time. Like if you printed something and it took 30 minutes, it wasn't much. It was like a couple bucks or so. You had to be a member of the library and live in the city limits or what have you, but they had it. I don't know if they have a laser cutter. I should probably check. But I encourage you that if lasers are something that you would like to learn and maybe you see how they could benefit your hobby, whether it be gaming or some other hobby, check to see if your town or city has a makerspace. Because typically what happens is they use the funds from the membership to buy the tools that they lack. A lot of members will donate tools, and I've donated a lot of tools to makerspaces. As a matter of fact, I donated my first laser cutter to a makerspace. It was a big homemade one. True story. Big homemade laser cutter that I made with a friend of mine named Patrick. We wrote a book on how to build your own laser cutter. This was years ago. And we built laser cutters. And I think to myself, what in the world was I thinking? Because they were good, but the safety and stuff, woo, man. Anyway, I highly encourage you to look into makerspaces to see if you have access to a laser cutter. If you have no interest in laser cutting and what it can do for you, skip this video. Say done, click off, and that's that. But if you would like to learn how I made this very simple, two-dimensional, it's made out of wood, quarter-inch plywood, this very simple play mat. I made this for a game I'm playing called Space Station Zero, which is a solo sci-fi war game, skirmish war game. You take a crew of like six or seven members. And it calls for a 22 by 30-inch board. And so I didn't have anything that size. I didn't have a neoprene mat that size, but I also wanted something that was going to stick around. Foam tends to get chippy and break and snap. And so I just said, I'm going to make something and I'm going to use my laser cutter and see what I can come up with. So this is what I came up with. And if you will continue watching this video, I'm going to explain how I did this, and you're going to see it getting cut. You're going to see it getting painted, all that good stuff. And then I end up with something like this. So that's enough talk. Let me get to the tutorial and show you how I made this. I'm using Inkscape, which is a free graphics program. And I basically started out drawing a rectangle at the desired dimensions, which the game states 22 by 30. I made a mistake and made mine 20 inches by 30 inches, but I could easily have just drawn this rectangle and set it to 22 by 30 if I'd have read the writing carefully. But I'll be starting with a basic shape of a rectangle in that size. I'm just zooming out so you can see the entire thing here. The labels are just for your benefit, so you can see the 30-inch side and the 20-inch side. What my goal was to put a grid on, or to create a grid on this board that would allow me to make various sizes of panels. Now, Inkscape has a lot of tools. There's no way I could teach you Inkscape in in a short amount of time. You just, if you decide you want to be doing lasering, you're going to have to find a program like Inkscape or Illustrator that gives you the tools to draw shapes, edit sizes, center things, wrap things. These are all things that you'll learn when you start learning these tools. But what I'm doing right here is I'm just going to be making a bunch of grid lines. These are going to be black lines in various widths and lengths. And I say they're black lines because when you're dealing with a laser, when you submit an image to a laser, typically every laser has colors associated with certain speeds and powers that the laser is going to fire. So in my case, anything that is red is going to be cut. The laser is actually going to cut through the wood all the way. Blue is just a light score. Purple or magenta is an engraving. Black is typically ignored. Not always, but in mine, it is. So I design in black for things that I'm not going to be needing my laser to worry about. And so what you're seeing right here is I'm just making a bunch of horizontal lines, and I'm making sure that they're spaced evenly between the top edge and the bottom edge. And Inkscape has tools that allow you to select all the different lines and then apply an even spacing. And now I made a copy of those, and I centered them with the original horizontal lines, and that now I'm selecting them all, and I'm going to make sure that they're vertically spaced the same right there. And so everything is sort of, you know, even. Your eye can pick out many, the human eye is amazing. It can pick out small imperfections in things. And when I'm designing things for like sci-fi, especially terrain or stuff, I try for more perfect than I do when I'm making fantasy terrain, because sci-fi terrain typically is precision made. Machines cut it or robots cut it. So right here, I'm doing the exact same thing that I did horizontally. I'm creating a bunch of vertical lines. And these vertical lines and horizontal lines are going to give me a grid pattern on this 30 by 20 image that I can use to create further panels of varying size. Now, I could just have eight by eight. I could just have a bunch of 8x8 panels, 8 horizontal and 8 vertical. But as you'll see later in the video, I'm going to have a mix of shapes that I can play with. Okay, the next step is to use this grid that I've created to make a bunch of panels. Now, I don't want the panels to go edge to edge. I don't want them to be butting up against all the other panels. I want there to be this slight gap between them. So what I'm doing here is I drew a basic 2x2 grid using a rectangle tool, and I made a copy of it. And the copy is sitting on top of it. But I'm going to do this thing called dynamic offset, which allows you to shrink an outer or a copy down inside the original so that you can create this sort of border, if you can see what I'm doing right here. So I've got this nice little inside panel, which is really what I want. I don't want the outer rectangle. I want that inner one. But to get that inner one, I have to first start with the outside one at the full size. Every one of these intersections where these horizontal and vertical lines is a snap point. So when you draw things, you can make it, Inkscape will make it to where you can snap to points. Makes it very easy to snap, just like that. Now, after I've got copies, I made 3 copies of the larger square or rectangle, and I pasted them in various corners. Now I'm going to make the smaller version. So first thing I do is I draw from an intersect point to an intersect point, another rectangle, and I made a copy of it. So there's a copy sitting on the original, and I do this dynamic inset again, and you gotta turn off the snap feature for that. So I drag it down, and I'm just eyeballing it, making sure it's about the same thickness as the bigger square below. And once I was happy with it, then it's just a matter of making a copy of the inner one and then pasting it in all of the remaining smaller rectangles. I won't bore you with that part of the process. I'm just, as you can see here, I paste a copy and then I center it so it snaps to where it needs to be. And then what I'm going to do is jump real fast. There I am. I'm all done. I did it all so that you didn't have to watch me do every square. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to select all of these rectangles. And what I want to do is I want to start removing the outer rectangles, which will create this sort of grid with walkways between each grid. I call them walkways, but I'm not sure what you sort of a path between all of the rectangles. So until you actually play with this, it's kind of hard to figure out what I'm doing here, but I'm just going around and selecting in groups some of the larger rectangles, and then I'm just deleting them away. And what I'm going to end up with in just a moment is basically a game board that has all of these various size squares and with a nice thick sort of gap between all of them. Here's the last little bit. You can see I select the outer rectangles and then delete them. I may have missed a couple. Yeah, I missed a few. When you start working like this, your eyes start getting crossed and you notice things. Like, for instance, there's one I missed, so I have to make a copy and paste it in there. Totally missed one of the squares. So after I did the cleanup, as you can see, you basically end up with this nice organized board full of small rectangles and large rectangles. Everything is sort of aligned vertically and horizontally, but there's something missing. It's just a bunch of rectangles, and honestly, it's kind of boring right now. So it occurred to me that what I needed to do was add some smaller details. So I'm going to pick these center rectangles right here, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to add some circles to form sort of maybe a drainage area or maybe an exhaust. You can do whatever you want. I could have made these like long oval-shaped rectangles that are curved on the ends, but I decided to go ahead and go with circles. Now, you can draw each one individually, but what you'll learn over time as you use things like this is you'll learn how to make copies and then group things and then make copies of bigger copies so that you can quickly make duplicates. So what I did here was I drew a rough estimate of the number of circles that I thought I might want in that rectangle. I aligned them along a horizontal axis, and then I basically spaced all of the circles out evenly. So I've got the left circle and the right circle where I want them, and then I select all the circles, and I say take the left and the right, and then center them all on the same line, and then space them evenly, and you'll see, there, boom, they're all spaced evenly. Then what I do is I group those, I make a copy, I make sure they're centered first, I make a copy, and then I drag that copy down and I have two rows. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to drag it all the way to the bottom because I want to space these things evenly. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to center those in the rectangle right there. They're centered horizontally and vertically, and then I can just make a bunch of copies of the row, and I think I made like 7 or 8 rows. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, there'll be 7 rows in all, I guess. Maybe 6. I don't know if I had room. No, 6. 5? It looks like I chose 5. And then I center those. Whoops. Center those horizontally, not vertically. I have to select them all, and then I'll click this button, which, there we go. It centers them all same distance apart. And then I group those circles and make a copy of it, and I'll paste that into additional rectangles where I want the this sort of exhaust system. Okay, now what I want to do is I want to add, I guess, rivets to the four corners of the remaining rectangles. So what I do is I just made a copy of the exhaust holes, and I'm going to center those in one of the rectangles, and I'm just going to keep the upper left, upper right, lower left, lower right, 4 circles, and I'm just manually placing them right now. And then what I'll do is I'll group them and center them horizontally to the rectangle, and then I'll center them vertically once I've got the copies made. So now that those are centered horizontally, I make a copy, I drag it up, and then I'll group these 4 together so that they are treated as one object, and I'll center them left, right, horizontally and vertically with the bigger rectangle. And then again, it's just a matter of making copies and snapping them, take the copy and then drag it, and it will snap in place where it needs to go. Or you can use the align horizontal and vertical buttons. The last step is going to be putting rivets in the 4 corners of the larger rectangles. So what I'm doing here is just sort of snapping them, aligning them with the other ones.
These are grouped together. I'm going to probably, I think I ungroup them. Let's see. Do I ungroup? Yeah, nope, I just made a copy. I'm just copying and pasting, and then I'll delete the extra ones that I don't need. And this will be the final bit of design. Now, you know, you could go crazy here. You could add cracks. You could add grill work. You could add electrical, you know, things in the floor. Really, it's just sort of what your skill and your imagination, you know, can handle. I just wanted a basic game board that I could play on. I didn't want to add too many bells and whistles because I just, since it's going to be multi-purpose, if I were adding wires or conduits and stuff, there might come a time when I don't want those things. And to me, those things are easier to add to the board later as scatter terrain than they are to add to the permanent board. So once I finished up with the rectangles, at this point, it is ready to take to the laser cutter. And all I had to do was put a red border around it, because the red, remember, is going to indicate to the laser to cut a board out. Everything else, all the blue that you see here, that is all going to get basically scored. It's like cutting a line in the wood, but not too deep. It just leaves a nice mark. And it'll hold up to like spray paint. When you spray paint over it, it won't fill in that line, and you'll still get that line at the end. And you'll see in the final, product that the detail work remained the same. Okay, what you're seeing here is basically just cleanup. I work in what's called layers. The lower layer was the grid system. I don't need it anymore, so I could delete it. It's all black lines except for the red outer line, which I'll leave. So I'm just taking the black lines and selecting random ones and just purging them out. You can select them individually, or you can draw around them and delete them. That leaves this nice red line and the blue, which will be scored. And this is my final image that I will be submitting to the software for my laser cutter. While I was doing the design, I was also prepping the wood. I have this quarter inch panel of wood that I painted with this dark gray. You don't have to do this part, but you'll understand in a minute why I'm pre-painting it before I'm lasering it. So I painted it gray, and then I used this special laser masking tape. It's not called masking tape. I can't remember what it's called, but it's just a wider bit of tape that you use. You put it over the wood so that the laser doesn't leave like the brown smoke residue. When you peel it off, it comes off clean, and it gives you these nice crisp lines. So here it is, all covered up in the tape. Then I drop the covered piece of wood in the laser, and I submit the file that you just saw me design. And this is not the actual speed of the laser. I'm doing this time lapse. I want to say it took about 7 or 8 minutes, maybe just a little bit longer. It wasn't doing anything other than scoring and that one outside cut line, which you see it doing right there. So it didn't take a really, really long time. Next, I was really careful to remove only certain parts of the masking tape or the covered tape. I wanted other pieces to be covered, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to spray paint all the uncovered parts with this sort of silver color. And then when I peel off the banding that's left behind and the holes there, the circles, it'll allow, those will be the original dark gray. So here it is, painted all silver. It looks bad, but trust me, that was what I was going for. And here is the fun part, trying to peel it off in one piece. I think I failed. I think it tore at some point. It did. You tear it all off, and it leaves behind this amazing gray line that has everything separated. Now remember, there are a bunch of little circles that are still cut too. So what I did was I removed them with a little bit of masking tape, actually Gorilla Tape. And the Gorilla Tape served a couple purposes. One, it damages the silver paint. It leaves like scratches and bad parts. You'll see me here just like throwing the tape down and just sort of giving it a really, really worn look and feel. So it pulls up the individual circles to reveal them for the rivets and stuff, but it also leaves behind sort of a worn look on the remaining silver panels. Now later on, I'm going to weather the entire thing with more different, well, with different color paints, some rust, things like that. But this is just ruining the paint job with some Gorilla Tape. Some of you are probably just thinking, why in the world did you do that? I could have left it pristine, but that's not what I wanted. This is an old space station. Everything's supposed to, you know, look rough and used and beat up. So the Gorilla Tape really comes in handy when you want to distress things like spray paint or acrylic paint. After I was done distressing the panels, I took various colors of paint. Some were like brass. I had some rust. What else? I had some metallic green that I painted most of the rivets. And I just went to town. What I did was I take the rust and I sort of fill in the damaged areas, and then I would take a paper towel and I would sort of wipe it or sort of just, I don't know, damp it real so that most of the paint came off, but it left just enough of the rust to give it a, you know, that I guess that look I was going for, the rusted look. I don't know if this technique has a name. I think I've seen it elsewhere. You basically just rub the rust into scratches and things like that, and then you just remove it with a towel like that. There you go. And it just leaves, it leaves just enough to look rusty without looking like you painted rust on. I don't know if that makes sense. And here you go. There's the final board. And then I got to play some Space Station Zero. This was just a scenario that I set up on the board. As you can see, it's a good size for what I was doing, a solo skirmish war game. You can see I've got miniatures and some other terrain set up on it. This really inspired me to start making more of my own scatter terrain. So I've been working recently on some 3D sci-fi scatter terrain that I'll be sharing with you very soon. But the board turned out great and I'm really enjoying playing on it.
All right, so there you go. That's how I made this durable wood panel to play not just Space Station Zero, but I can use this for other sci-fi skirmish war games like Stargrave or 5 Parsecs from Home. Those are two others that I play that I definitely plan on using this. I actually have an idea for another one. The new one I want to make is 2x2, which is traditionally, not traditionally, but it's typical of what I use for Stargrave or 5 Parsecs from Home. 5 Leagues from the Borderlands is the fantasy version of 5 Parsecs. But yeah, making this was fun. And of course, it gave me more ideas. And this is two-dimensional, all right? Not extremely difficult to make. I've been working on some 3D terrain because my brain never stops. I've always got ideas in my mind. I see things that you, my friends, post on Facebook that give me ideas. A guy the other day posted a picture on one of the sci-fi game Facebook groups, and he had this piece of terrain, and I was like, I'm taking that, I'm going to steal it, I'm going to make it into a laser version, which I did. It's slightly different, but it was close to his. I sent him one as a thank you. I told him, I said, give me your address, I want to send you one as a thank you for the inspiration. But that lit a fire under me to start making some more of my own scattered terrain. So there you go. I hope you like this. I know that this can be intimidating. Anytime you're learning a new tool or a new piece of software or a new technique, it takes practice. You have to learn how to do it. I'm going to tell you, when I first started using Inkscape, I didn't have a clue. That program overwhelmed me. That application it made my head spin. There were so many buttons, so many features, so many special things. What I've learned is, let's say there are 1,000 features in Inkscape, I probably use less than 10% of them. Probably 20 or 30 commands that I use most of the time to make stuff like this. And it usually involves things like centering, copying, rotating, resizing. Once you learn the basics of what you need to do, the other stuff you'll figure out on your own, but you can do stuff like this with very little skill in Inkscape, all right? I will also put a link in the video description below of some awesome tutorials in Inkscape that I used when I was learning Inkscape. The guy in question has put out hundreds more videos. That may overwhelm you, but his videos are very short. They're usually like 2 or 3 minutes, and they teach a certain technique or two or three. I watched like maybe 50 or 60 of them, and I would go and do what he did, and all of a sudden, one day I woke up and I was like, I'm actually pretty good at Inkscape. I've actually learned things, how to do things that he hasn't shown yet, but that I found videos later that he's like, oh, this is how you do this. So I've gotten pretty confident in the software. And if you want to get doing stuff like this, just understand you're going to have to get confident in either Inkscape or Illustrator. There are, what's the other one? Affinity. There's a bunch that it's graphic software that is going to allow you to do stuff like this, but it's color coded. Remember, red for cut, blue for score, purple or I guess violet or pink even for engraving, depending on the machine. So there you go. If you have any questions, post them in the comments below. I will do my absolute best to answer them. I am by no means a laser expert. I am by no means an Inkscape expert, but I will certainly help you where I can by pointing you in the right directions. If you're looking for a laser, check to see if you have a makerspace nearby. If you are looking to buy a laser, don't ask me. The commercial lasers, which is what I have for my business, are on a totally different level than like the hobbyist lasers. Do your research though, because you're going to want to look into warranties and, you know, reliability. Talk to people who own the machines. Get on Facebook groups that are usually dedicated to certain machines and ask questions. You just definitely don't take my word for it. It's a rabbit hole that if you fall down, it's a fun rabbit hole, but there's going to be a lot of expectations on you in terms of learning stuff. All right, that's all I've got for this video. I do apologize that it went really long, but I hope you enjoyed this. If you want to see more videos like this, let me know. I will tell you right now, the videos that I put up on my crafting channel, they're my videos. They're going to be what floats my boat. Whatever I'm interested in making, that's what I'm making. I know that that isn't probably what a lot of my viewers want to hear, but I do this for you, but I do it for you based on the things I'm doing for me. And I make the videos that I want to make, and I know that upsets a lot of you when I make videos that maybe are not relevant to you, but I'm an engineer, I play tabletop games, and I go where the river takes me. So that's it. This is Jim, the Tabletop Engineer. I'll be back hopefully very soon with another crafting video. I'm kind of on a tear now, so expect some more coming. All right, everybody, take care.